In this first talk, what we're going to be looking at is Israel and the Middle East, and again, what we're going to put into it Brexit. So, who would have anticipated just a few years ago that Israel would now be working with her Arab neighbours, that Russia would have moved into Syria, and that Britain would have voted to leave the EU? But with Bible in hand, we can make sense of these events, because they're all part of God's plan that is leading to great changes. And I believe that now Britain has decided she's going to leave the EU, things are going to move quite rapidly in Europe, in Britain, and in the Middle East. But there are so many signs, thrilling signs, that tell us that the coming of the Lord Jesus is near. Now, the Apostle Paul, when writing to the Thessalonians, they had signs of their times. Jesus had told them about the return of the Lord Jesus at the head of the Roman armies in AD 70 to bring destruction upon Jerusalem, and they were able to see the signs of the times. And Paul wrote to the Thessalonians to say that of the times and the seasons, brethren, ye have no need that I write unto you. For yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so cometh as a thief in the night. For when they shall say, peace and safety, then sudden destruction cometh upon them, as travail upon a woman with child, and they shall not escape. But ye, brethren, are not in darkness that that day should overtake you as a thief. So the word for times, we have chronos, chronology. In Galatians chapter 4, he uses the same word, but in the fullness of the time, God sent forth his son. So God has a timetable. When the day comes, then actions happen. So those are the times. The seasons are the time period around that time. Now, we don't know the day or the hour of the coming of the Lord Jesus, but we are in the season of that coming. And God has given us so many signs in order that we might be awake and alert and watching for that coming. And the Lord Jesus knew what would be the appropriate message for 21st century Christadelphians. And it was, behold, I come as a thief. Blessed is he that watcheth and keepeth his garments, lest he walk naked, and they see his shame. So the Lord Jesus was aware that in the 21st century there would be brothers and sisters who were not watching the times and the seasons. And so his coming would overtake them as a thief in the night. But Paul says, we should be awake. We should know the seasons, and therefore be bending every effort to be prepared for that coming. And Jesus condemned the leaders of his day. There were times and seasons for them. Daniel had given time periods indicating when Messiah was going to be born, but they were ignoring them. And he called them hypocrites. They could look at the sky and see what the tomorrow's weather was going to be, but they couldn't see from the word of God the signs of their time. And we must make sure, brothers and sisters, that we are not in that category. We have so much. There never has been a generation that has had so many signs. Whether we look at Britain, whether we look at Europe, whether we look at the Vatican, whether we look at Russia, whether we look at the Middle East, and look at Israel. All these balls, as it were, are up in the air. And the angels are working so hard to bring about that stage, setting the stage, which will bring the nations down against Israel, which will lead to Christ and the saints coming to deliver his people. The whole world is being realigned, and the Times in Britain, day after the election results were declared it was a Brexit. The Brexit, sorry, was an earthquake. They recognised this is going to be a big change for Britain. And truly, it has been and will be. Now, before we get going, and I just want us to look at some of the stepping stones, some of the signposts that tell us that the coming of the Lord Jesus is near. And they're signs which have to be fulfilled before the Master can come. And the first is, and was a time of great rejoicing in our brotherhood when World War I, in the words of Revelation chapter 16, the River Euphrates was dried up. Britain went into the Middle East, drove out the Turks, and that enabled the Jews to go back. And Britain and Israel at the moment are having discussions as to how they're to celebrate the Balfour Declaration, which will be 100 years next year, God willing. So that was a great stepping stone, a great sign to our community that there could be a possibility of Israel having a state. And then during the 1920s and 30s and 40s, great movement of Jews from Europe back to their land and establishing themselves there. And then in 1948, when the State of Israel was set up, again, it was, read the editorials of the Christadelphian magazine and other magazines of that time. Great rejoicing within our brotherhood. We recognised the hand of God. Israel at last were a nation. And we knew that it was necessary for the Jews to be back in their land before the Lord Jesus could come back. So that was a big sign. And again, there were many baptisms that followed that event. And then 1967, when the Jews took control of Jerusalem, again, that was exciting because we knew from the prophets that Jerusalem was to be the burdensome stone and Israel had to be in possession of Jerusalem. So the Lord Jesus couldn't have come back before 1967 because that's when they had possession of Jerusalem. And during the 80s and the 90s and onwards, a time of great anti-Semitism within Europe, so that the Jews in Europe who had been very comfortable were forced to come back to their land. And we've seen almost half the world Jewish population returning to the land of Israel. Something I don't think any of us expected to see. Absolutely amazing, the number of Jews, which makes it all the more frightening when we know that when God comes against Israel, if two-thirds are being cut off and there are 6 million Jews in the land, that's a frightening figure, isn't it, brothers and sisters and young people, that are going to die. And today we see, and that's why we read Isaiah chapter 2, and we'll come and look at that in more detail, we see that Israel is making alliances with the Arab nations to the east, with India, with China, with Japan. She's turned her back on the EU because of all the problems she has with trading there, and is now turning eastwards. Isaiah, under inspiration of God, recorded, 2,600 years ago. Absolutely amazing how Scripture comes to pass exactly as God says. And we see Israel very prosperous. Again, we shall be looking at this. Incredible wealth is on Israel's doorstep, transforming the economy of the country, making her a desirable prey. And we know, lying soon into the future, are the assembly of the nations to come down against Israel to take her, to destroy her as a nation, to take Israel and to take Egypt. And that then will be followed by Armageddon, when Christ destroys the enemies of Israel. So we have seen many stepping stones, and we're privileged to be alive at this end point in time. We can look back, we can see so much that has happened in the past 100 years. And that convinces us that God is in control. He does know all things. His purpose is being worked out precisely as he has set down in the prophets. So I wanted to start, so I know the references are up there, but just turn to them in your Bibles, to Daniel chapter 11. We haven't time to look at the whole chapter. It's a long chapter, but it's about the history from the time of Daniel onwards, about two powers to the north and south of Israel. We'll look at a map in a moment. But then when we come to the end of the chapter, verse 40, it's telling us about things which lie in our day. And what has happened in the past is a miniature of what is to happen in the future. There are to be two powers, a king of the north and a king of the south, at the time of the end, and Israel piggy in the middle. And Daniel chapter 11, verse 40 tells us that at the time of the end, so it's quite clear this is talking about end times, shall the king of the south push at him, whoever the him is, we'll come back to that in a moment, and the king of the north shall come against him like a whirlwind, with chariots, horsemen, many ships, shall enter into the countries, shall overflow and pass over. Goes into the glorious land. Some escape Edom, Moab, and Ammon. Land of Egypt shall not escape, but have power over the treasures of Egypt. He'll be helped by the Libyans and the Ethiopians. And then verse 44, tidings trouble him, and he goes forth into the land of Israel. And verse 45, he shall plant the tabernacles of his palace between the seas in the glorious holy mountain. Yet he shall come to his end, and none shall help him. So between the seas, between the Dead Sea and the Mediterranean Sea in Jerusalem. So this king of the north power will not only destroy Israel as a nation, but will plant itself there as a dominant power. And it will appear to the world that there is no God in Israel. Christianity will have triumphed over the Jews. Now we need to know who the him is. And if we go earlier in the chapter, we shall find that the him is the one who possesses Constantinople. And so we believe that that beginning verse, the time of the end, was now 100 years ago, the time of World War I, Britain pushing at Turkey, the Ottoman Empire, that was in possession of Constantinople. And due to that work, freed the land, so that Israel could go back as a nation. And what we're waiting for is a northern power, the king from the north, to take him, and it is still the Ottoman power. Britain wasn't able to drive the Turk out of Turkey. Turkey still possesses Constantinople. But in the latter days, and it still lies in to our future, the northern power, Og of Ezekiel 38, king of the north of Daniel chapter 11, is going to come down into Turkey and take Turkey. And with all that is happening today, that's not a surprising thing, is it? And we're going to see how Russia has been planting her footsteps all around Turkey in our second part. But this is telling us that this king of the north is going to possess Constantinople, be a warlike people with chariots, horsemen, many ships, and is going to sweep down coastal plain into Egypt, take the treasures of Egypt, and then come up and destroy Jerusalem and the Israeli nation. Now we know that that northern power, that king of the north, is Russia. And we see Russia today as a very military power. It is assembling, having taken Crimea, it is using Crimea as a forward base for its aircraft, for its ships, for its troops. We saw how from there they moved into Syria. And as I say, we shall see just how Turkey is being ringed by Russian troops. So we know that we're in this time period when these things are going to come to pass. And the original situation of a northern power and the Greek Empire that succeeded the Medo-Persian that Daniel lived to see. The next one was the Greek Empire divided after, forgotten his name. Who was the great Alexander the Great? When Alexander the Great died at the age of 32, eventually his kingdom was divided between two great powers, the southern one, the Ptolemies, and the Seleucids, the king of the north. And that and Israel, piggy in the middle, as these two fought against each other. And that forms a backdrop to the situation that we're going to see in the Middle East. A northern power, much greater than the king of the north, because Russia is going to be involved. A power in the south, much greater than Egypt, because we believe Britain and Australia and the other Commonwealth countries are going to be involved in the south there. And it's all over Israel, what Israel is going to experience. Now, Ezekiel 38, we're going to look at in our second talk, but that will fill in more detail. But what I want to turn to is this remarkable friendship that exists at the moment between the Russian President Putin and the Israeli leader Netanyahu. This is not normal. Russians are usually anti-Semitic. It is truly remarkable that in these last days, we have a friendship between a Russian leader and an Israeli leader. And he has met with Netanyahu 4 times in the last 12 months. And allegedly Israel's friend, Obama, has only gone to see once. And they have many telephone conversations. There are still 200,000 Jews left in Russia. 1 in 6 of the Jews in Israel are from Russia. So that means that there's a strong Russian presence in Israel. And this was a headline, Israel and Russia BFFS. And I, being the wrong generation, I had to Google it to find out what BFFS is. Best friends forever, which I'm sure you youngsters could have told me, but I didn't know that. And Putin and Netanyahu talk economic ties about energy. Israelis are wanting the Russians to come and help them develop the gas fields off their coast. I say, this is something which is truly remarkable. Now, just go back to Isaiah, but not to chapter 2, but to chapter 10. And we have a little verse there which suddenly, in 2015-16, springs to life. Isaiah chapter 10 and verse 20 and 21. And clearly from the context, I haven't time to study it, take my word, that this is talking about end times. And it shall come to pass in that day, the day of the kingdom, that the remnant of Israel, and such as are escaped of the house of Jacob, shall no more stay, rely on, and there's an example of how Isaiah uses that word, will no more rely upon him that smote him, but shall rely upon Yahweh, the Holy One of Israel, in truth. The remnant shall return, even the remnant of Jacob, unto the mighty God. So what's that telling us, brothers and sisters and people? Here was Isaiah writing 2,600 years ago, saying that in the latter days, before they turn and recognize their Messiah, which they do after the Battle of Armageddon, they will be trusting in the one that smote them, in him that smote them. We know who's going to smite Israel. Ezekiel 38 and the other passages are so clear, it is the Russians. So we're seeing that this is spot on. Today the Israelis are trusting in the Russians to help them. And that's a truly remarkable prophecy of our time. Now why is it that Putin is such a friend to the Jews? Well, it's the angelic hand. When Putin was a young lad, he was in a poor family. Both parents went out to work. And when he came home from school, his next door neighbours used to take him in and look after him. Now, those were Jews, practicing Jews, at a time of communism when it was pretty dangerous to openly be a Jew. But they displayed their Jewishness. And Putin was so grateful for what they did to him as a young man, he never forgot his gratitude towards the Jews. He had many Jewish friends. Many of the oligarchs are Jews. Many in his government are Jews. When, about 6 years ago, he went to Israel, he found his primary, you don't use primary here, but when you're a youngster, that's the first school you go to. He found one of his teachers was Jewess and had emigrated to Israel and was living in quite poverty in Tel Aviv, and so he bought a flat so that she didn't have any money worries. And that's truly staggering, isn't it, brothers and sisters? How the angels arranged so long ago, 50 years ago, that this young lad should have practicing Jews as his neighbours. And that left a burning impression upon him. And he has wanted to help Israel. Now, there is another strand to all this. If we just go back a year ago, the Israelis had their elections. Well, it was more than a year ago, because I think they had the elections about February, and it took them ages to work out a coalition. There's 120 seats in the Knesset, so you've got to build up a coalition. There's lots and lots of little parties, no one big party. The pundits expected that the Netanyahu's party, which had about 26 seats, that they would be losing seats. Instead, they gained them, they got 30 seats. And it took a long time, but eventually he put together a coalition of the Jewish state, Shas, the ultra-Orthodox party, United Tory Judaism, and the centre-right party, Kalanun. And with those, he had a slim majority, he had 61 seats. So everybody said, well, that's not going to last very long, Israeli politics being what it is, but it lasted a whole year. And then in May of this year, he took on board the remaining right-wing party, Israel Betanu, Our Home Israel. Now, the interesting thing about all these parties that have come into an alliance is that they very strongly are for not giving up land to the Palestinians. They feel very strongly that Israel, this is our land. God has given it to us. These are mainly the religious parties. And so quite an interesting time when Americans, Britain and Europe is putting pressure on Israel to hand back to the Palestinians. The government party policy is all, we're not going to give it up. Now, by taking on this particular party, Israeli Betanu, he brought in their leader, Russian-born leader, and his founder, which is this gentleman, Avigdor Lieberman. He was born in Russia about the age of 20. He made aliyah to Israel and set up this party of Russian people. He is very friendly to Putin, he's very friendly to the Russians, he speaks their language, he knows how they deal with matters. And as part of the deal, bringing him into the government, absorbing his party, he made him defence minister, which of course in Israel is a very prominent and important role, because Israel has many enemies. And the Russians feel that this is a man they can do business with, because, you know, he speaks the lingo. And so that was quite an interesting step in Israel wanting to work with Russia. Now, Israel's neighbours have had abundant energy. And it's only in recent times that in this Levant basin off the coast of Egypt and Israel and Lebanon and Syria has been discovered vast amounts of gas. And there's a report back in May that this Levant basin could still hold undiscovered resources of 6.6 billion barrels of oil equivalent. Experts estimate that there are between 10 and 15,000 billion cubic meters of gas in the East Mediterranean basin. Now, you're probably aware that the biggest reserve that Israel has discovered is the Leviathan, which is about 490 billion cubic meters. So they've got, there's 20 or 30 Leviathans waiting to be discovered in that region there. And Israel herself thinks that in the territory that she controls, this is day before yesterday, vast amounts of gas newly found off Israeli coast have given the country a wealth of options. It could be one of the great defining moments in Israeli's history. Large deposits of natural gas off Israel's Mediterranean coast have long been known about. The Leviathan field alone could meet all Israel's energy needs. But if Israel's energy minister is right, there could be 2,200 million cubic metres still to be discovered or explored. Put it another way, that's the equivalent of another four Leviathans. Now, she only needs one, that is a small country, 8 million population. But it seems that off the coast of Israel, there is the equivalent of four more Leviathans. Now, the energy, the money that has, and the influence that energy carries with it, puts Israel in a very strong position. And it's not just off the coast. In the Dead Sea, an old oil well they've had another look at, and they find that they haven't exhausted it, nowhere near. There's about, using Australian dollars, about $420 million worth of oil in the bottom of the Dead Sea, and easy to get at. The well has already been drilled, it just needs exploiting a bit. And up to the north in the Golan Heights, which again America has been trying to pressurize Israel to give up the Golan Heights, again vast reserves of oil have been found. And what is truly remarkable, that the oil seams in which this oil is found are 10 times thicker than normal. And when you find oil in other places, they're usually in fairly shallow strata. What they discovered on the Golan, 10 times thicker than normal, there is an abundant amount of oil up there, as long as they can exploit it. So we see that when the prophets talk about the wealth of Israel in the latter days, what a prize it will be to the king of the north, to Russia, we see angelic hands. These materials, the oil and the gas, I believe, was laid down in the time of the flood, and have no use for millennia until we come to our time, when oil and gas is king, isn't it? How wonderfully the Israelis have now discovered these things. We can see the vast potential for wealth in Israel. And is another reason for Russia's involvement. You see, Israel has already developed the Tamar field, and that's supplying gas. They're just beginning to develop Tamar Southwest, spending $344 million on a new gas well there. But there are these like Dolphin and Dalit and Tanin, and here's the Leviathan, which haven't yet been developed. The Mediterranean is very deep here. It's about 2 or 3 kilometres of water before you get down to the shore, and then you've got to go down. So not easy to develop. And in the Cypriot zone is Aphrodite. And one of the concerns is, well, if we develop these fields, how are we going to export gas? And Israel's not alone in that problem, because to the south of Leviathan, the Italians, on behalf of Egypt, which is down here, has found what is probably the biggest gas field in the world ever to be discovered, the Zohar. So Zohar and Leviathan and Aphrodite are waiting to be developed. And you need vast amounts of money to be able to develop these. So the thinking is, well, let's loop those together. Let's work together. Let's cooperate. Israel, Egypt, Cyprus. Bring pipelines back to the countries, because they will need some of the gas. But to link up to Cyprus, and then from Cyprus, come across to Greece, and then from Greece up into Europe. That's what Putin is very keen to do. The Americans have different ideas.
The Americans want a development that will take it to Cyprus and then on up to Turkey.
But that's because, at the moment, Turkey is very reliant upon Russian gas. About 60% of Turkey's gas comes from Russia. And what America is desperate to do is to break the stranglehold that Russia has on the gas markets. So America is favouring sending it up to Turkey, so Turkey isn't so reliant on Russia. Russia, naturally, favours sending it up to Greece, helping Greece, and then selling on into Europe. So, behind the scenes, a big battle. And what Russia is saying to Israel is, look, if we come and help you, we can guarantee that your enemies, Hezbollah, Hamas, Syria and ISIS and that, are kept under control. So the last thing you want, having spent billions of dollars on developing an oil field or gas field, is for terrorists to come along and just fire a few missiles at it and blow it out of the water. A bit of waste of money. So what Russia is holding, the bait, as it were, that Russia is holding out to Israel, if you let us develop, then we can guarantee the safety of your wells. So this is an article back in May from the Asia Times. Russia seeks bigger Middle East role through alliance with Israel. While it initially started as coordination between Russian and Israeli forces in Syria to prevent any clash over the Syrian airspace, it's now expanding into a sort of strategic alliance. Netanyahu, Putin discussed the crisis in Syria, and more importantly, the possibility of Russia's Gazprom developing Israel's Leviathan gas fields in the eastern Mediterranean. A development that, if materialized, would have enormous implications for the future of the Middle East, as it can, to a considerable extent, alter erstwhile regional alignments. As such, were Russia and Israel to strike a deal to develop the Leviathan, it would have enormous geopolitical implications, not only for Iran, but also for Saudi Arabia, Israel, and the US. Needless to say, Russian involvement in Israel would minimize the risk of Iran or Hezbollah attacking these installments. Israel's interest in taking Gazprom on board, therefore, has clear strategic implications too. So, we're in early days. We shall just have to wait and see. But Russia is very keen, and Israel is very keen, that they work together to develop this wealth. Now, let's just go back to Isaiah chapter 2. And we read that chapter. The early verses are verses which we know very well. And they're very clearly about the time of the kingdom. Now, Isaiah, like many of the prophets, often either at the beginning of a prophecy, tells us the end of the matter, and then tells us how we reach that matter. And this is one of those. Others tell us of things as they're coming to pass, and then jump to the future and have an end picture. So this one clearly tells us of the kingdom age, and a wonderful time of blessing when Jesus is king. Well, how do we get there? And that's what verses 6 to 9 tell us. They tell us how Israel is prior to that time. And this is what we're reading here. O house of Jacob, come ye and let us walk in the light of Yahweh. Therefore, thou hast forsaken thy people, the house of Jacob. Why? Because they be replenished from the east, and are soothsayers like the Philistines. They please themselves and the children of strangers. The land is full of silver and gold, no end of their treasures, horses, chariots, idols that they worship, things that their own fingers have made. They all bow down to them, therefore forgive them not. And that's a pretty good picture of Israel today. They are replenished from the east. the word replenished, and I think the brother that read a slightly different version, it was the word filled. They're filled from the east. They're making trade agreements with, I'll say, nations to the east of them. Saudi Arabia, India, Japan, China. They're making agreements, trade agreements. Stuff is coming in from China. Stuff is going from Israel to China. They are replenished from the east. Soothsayers like the Philistines, not quite so easy, but I understand that the Philistines were very interested in wanting to know what is going to happen. And like the Babylonians, you know, using the liver, consulting the liver, things like that. If that is what Isaiah is talking about, then indeed Israel is very much soothsayers like the Philistines were in Isaiah's day. Israel is very keen to know what is going to happen. I do know of a meeting between a sister on holiday in Turkey with this young man. I started to talk, and he turned out he was from Mossad. He was very interested to know what this sister understood from the Bible, what was going to happen. And in fact, were arranged at least two meetings, if not three meetings, between Mossad and this sister's father. So they are very keen to know what is going to happen. Their intelligence is second to none. And so they have their fingers on the pulse. They know what is happening. So instead of trusting in God, they're trusting in their own skills. They please themselves in the children of strangers. To please themselves in the original, to clap hands, to be companions of or friends with. It's shaking hands. Again, similar to this one here. They're making agreements with children of strangers, non-Jews. They're making alliances with nations who are not Jewish. And God counts that as trespass in his eyes. The land is full of silver and gold. Well, you know, we've seen the vast reserves that are being found. The land is full of horses and chariots. Well, that's the military terminology of Ezekiel's day. Today we would say Iron Dome, ballistic missiles, tanks, all sorts of aircraft and that kind of thing. The land is also full of idols. What is an idol? It's what you trust in, what you bow down to, what you worship. And what it is that Israel worships today are the things that they have made, the weaponry that they have made of their own hands. Their own fingers have made it. They've had financial help from America, but very largely the weaponry that they have made has been of their own devices. And that makes them feel very secure. When polls are taken of different countries, how secure do you feel living in your country? Israel's way above Australia and Britain and America. They feel, surrounded by all their enemies, but they feel much more secure than you do in this country here than we do in Britain. So, you know, that's exactly what God says. They bow down to these things, they trust in them, instead of trusting in God. That's why Russia has got to think an evil thought. And the alliances which Israel has made with Russia will turn to dust. And all the wonderful defense mechanisms that they have built are going to just crumble into the dust and be worthless against the onflowing invasion. They will indeed be humble. They will see the futility of their idols. And there will be the remnants who will turn to their God and cry out for help and for salvation. And God will hear that. Now, the change of attitude between the Arab countries towards Israel has been truly remarkable. Just a few years ago, we know in Ezekiel 38 that it speaks of Sheba and Dedan, the merchants of Tarshish and the young lions being opposed to this future invasion of Israel. And it seems so odd that Sheba and Dedan, the Arab nations, surely they will be saying to Russia, yes, come on, get rid of the Jews. But no, they are foremost. Different attitude. They are friends with Israel. And that's what we're seeing happening today. Truly remarkable change. And there are many discussions. Israel has been helping the Saudis for a long time with intelligence, the Jordanians, the Egyptians. They're realizing that the Israeli-Palestinian problem is just a sign. The problem for the Arabs are their own peoples, not Israel. Israel shares a common enemy with them. They are both afraid of Iran. And they can see, with America seemingly wanting to turn her back on the Middle East, that their friend is actually Israel. And with Israeli help, they can go places. But again, this is exactly what, you know, Scripture led us to believe. That there would be Arab nations siding with Israel and Israel making alliances with them. Does Israel threaten these sunny states in any way at all? No. The same forces that threaten them threaten us. Whether it's sunny extremism, Muslim Brotherhood, whatever. They see them as a threat. So there has been a realignment. They see Israel as a strong country on their side of the divide. And so there is something to be hopeful for. And these are just some of the headlines. Israel making agreements with China, with the sunny Arab states, with India, with Jordan. Israel now has a place in NATO, working very strongly with the Jordanians. This is a revolution in Israeli links to Arab countries. And just a couple of weeks ago, a historic visit by the Egyptian foreign minister to Israel. They want to build ties. Do I gather chairs are arriving? No, I'll carry on. Want to build ties between the two countries and find some solution to the Palestinian problem. And I believe that with Russia working with Israel, suppressing ISIS as much as they can, bringing the Palestinians on board, that we're going to see quite a transformation of the Middle East. And that time of peace and safety that Ezekiel 38 speaks about will become a reality. Israel is on overdrive to try and divert the Palestinians away from wanting to do war with them to helping them economically so that they become friendly. And these are just, again, some of the recent headlines. This last one is very interesting. What Israel wants to do is to build an artificial island about 5 kilometres off the coast of Gaza, put an airport on there, and a marina for the Palestinians so that they can have a link. The Gaza Strip is too small for it. The idea is provide them somewhere out in the ocean which Israel can monitor so it's not used for smuggling. So whether that will ever come about, one doesn't know, but the Chinese and the Russians are very keen on putting money into that scheme. The other is the development of the Dead Sea. So the picture is of the Dead Sea, and overlaid upon that is the map of Israel, and the Hoslems. I've been writing about this for about 15 years. It goes way going back. So the idea is from the Red Sea, build the pipeline down to the Dead Sea, bring water from the sea to fill up the Dead Sea, which is evaporating,
at the rapid rate, as you can see from here. And at the same time as the water flows down, it will generate hydroelectric power to drive desalination plants. That water can be used by southern Jordan and southern Israel. Israel at the moment has to pipe water down from the Galilee all down Israel down to the south. If this gets off the ground and Israel and Jordan sort out their water to the south, then Israel will supply what they used to bring down here to northern Jordan, which is a long way from the Dead Sea. And so it's a partnership which benefits both sides. What is also very interesting as Bible students has been the relationship between Britain and Israel. Under David Cameron has pushed that Israel is a key market for Britain. And we've seen a big transformation in trade between Israel and Britain. And I believe this is one of the reasons why Britain is being blessed at the moment, because she is a friend of Israel. And Israeli companies are being encouraged not to go to California to develop your products, but to come to Britain, which is only a 2-hour time difference, not half a day away, much easier to get to. So great drive for Israel and Britain to have a close role. And that's truly remarkable, because we were all saddened to see Britain withdraw from the Middle East, and those that were sceptical said, Britain's never going to return. But we're seeing Britain returning to Israel, returning to the Middle East. And that brings me now to Brexit. Just turn to Isaiah chapter 23. It's just amazing what Isaiah has to say about our day. Isaiah 23 and verse 15 talks about the power of Tyre being like a harlot and going through a period when things were grim. But then there'll be a change and she will sing again. So this is what Isaiah 23, verse 15. It shall come to pass in that day, the day of the kingdom age, Tyre shall be forgotten 70 years, according to the days of one king. After the end of 70 years, shall Tyre sing as an harlot. Take an harp, go about the city, thou harlot that has been forgotten. Make sweet melody, sing many songs that thou mayest be remembered. And it shall come to pass, after the end of 70 years, that Yahweh will visit Tyre, and she shall turn to her hire, and shall commit fornication with all the kingdoms of the world upon the face of the earth. And her merchandise and her hire shall be holiness to Yahweh. It shall not be treasured nor laid up, for her merchandise shall be for them that dwell before Yahweh to eat sufficiently and for durable clothing. Awful lot packed into there. But haven't time to look at Britain being the latter-day Tarshish power. But we believe that is the case. And so Tyre was to be forgotten for 70 years. When do we start that clock? Well, to me it seems a reasonable starting date. The end of World War II marked the last stage in Britain's history. Britain was on her knees. She had given everything in battling against Germany. And we were very thankful for the support that the Australians sent food parcels to help us in those days. So 70 years ago, Britain was on her knees. And because of that, she sought alliances with the EU. We're never going to be a great nation again. We'll have to join up with the EU and become a little cog in a big wheel. But here we are, 70 years and 9 months later, and Britain has broken away from Europe. Obviously, she's voted to do that. The actual physical doing of that hasn't come yet, but it is this it is truly remarkable that there's 70 years, not months, Britain has voted to break the shackles that link her,
that she is strong enough to stand on her own feet. She can have a worldwide role. And that's what Isaiah said. All kingdoms upon the face of the world upon the earth. That's what she's wanting to do. Link up with the Commonwealth again. Link up with Israel, Middle East, India, Australia, New Zealand. And trade with them. I believe that's what we're going to see. But what Isaiah goes on to say is that's not going to last very long, because this is the time of the kingdom. The Lord Jesus is going to come back. And we believe that Britain will be one of those countries that very early on submits to Jesus as the King of Israel. And she will use her resources to help bring the Jews back post-Armageddon. So we believe we're living in this time period, but shortly that is going to be fulfilled. But beforehand, Britain has this role to play, to be a world power, to become a trading nation again. And that's what she's good at. So bring in the seats. I'm going to just carry on talking. Just bring the seats in, put them out, people sit down. We can do both. Two things together. So what was very interesting, just 3 years ago, Britain, United Services, behind my finger there, the Royal United Services Institute is a British think tank that advises the government on their military strategy. Now you see the headline to the paper there, a return to east of Suez, UK military deployment to the Gulf. And that was so exciting. Now, Britain left the Gulf in the 1970s. Here Britain was proposing she had to go back and build up her ties in the Gulf. And just as the UK withdrawal in 1971 created a security vacuum that drew the US somewhat unwillingly further into the affairs of the Gulf, the US's cooling of its engagement seems to be drawing the UK back in. There is significantly more at stake in this renewed relationship than mere military posturing. By enhancing the UK's relationships with the states of the Southern Gulf, the UK is committing to the security and longevity of the Arab Gulf states. It seems the UK is taking on this burden of underpinning security in the Gulf, both out of necessity and of desire. Certainly, it is a considerable economic benefit to the UK to be the leading European and indeed Western player in the Gulf. And it is undeniable that the UK defence and policy establishment still finds it straightforward, enjoyable even, to engage with their equivalents in the Gulf, in a way perhaps which often eluded the Americans. Because Britain is a monarchy, the Arab states are monarchies, there's a much closer relationship between them. And so Britain's policy now is into Suez and east of Suez. We shall expect now she has broken away for that to grow. In the past, this was in the 1920s, Britain had a very strong influence there, but step by step she withdrew and, say, joined the EU in 1973. Now things have changed, great changes. And these are some of the more recent headlines, you know, how's it going to affect Brexit, how's it going to affect Britain and the Gulf states, and as far as they're concerned, it's good. The pound has plummeted quite alarmingly. We who visit your country, it's much cheaper to come to Britain. We look forward to seeing you. And as far as the sound is, you know, they invest a lot of their money in property in London and get more houses, bigger houses for their money. So they're all pleased, and it doesn't seem that Brexit is going to affect matters. Actually, the EU, Britain in the EU, was a stumbling block for the Arab nations. Britain out of the EU is a much better companion for them. So, interesting times. So, it's not inconceivable that a new Conservative Prime Minister might redouble the outreach to the Gulf if it can partially out, offset the spiraling uncertainty in EU relations. The Gulf is one of the few areas where Britain holds a natural advantage, partly through a sense of shared history, but additionally through the soft asset of the British royal family. And this closeness offers the UK an opportunity in the coming months. Rules in the Gulf Council states have, in any case, no strong attachments to the EU, and they recall the frustration, with frustration, the failure of the lengthy negotiations for a free trade agreement. So the world is Britain's oyster, and Commonwealth countries are going to form, I believe, the basis of that. And already, Theresa May has got so many of these countries, Australia, India, Africa, Canada, America, all wanting to sign free trade agreements with her, which Britain wasn't able to do as a member of the EU, because in the EU, every 28 members had to agree. One member, France, very often didn't want free trade agreements because it would affect her own industry, so nothing happened. An awful lot can now happen. It's a very exciting dynamic for picture, and much to encourage us. And the Queen has held together the Commonwealth. And she was against Britain remaining. She wanted Britain to leave. She is in a difficult position as far as politics is concerned, but she had her subtle way of doing things. So when ministers came to visit her, she would just say, give me three good reasons why we should remain in the EU. And of course, they couldn't do it. And what is remarkable, a book has been written to celebrate her 90th birthday. And this is the title of the book, The Servant Queen and the King She Serves. And that king is the Lord Jesus Christ. She recognises that she is doing a service to God. Bible forms an important part of her life, and the Commonwealth forms another important aspect of her life. And this was a writer about this book, which has just been published. Britain's Queen Elizabeth II reflects on Jesus' central role in her life in a new book ahead of her 90th birthday, called Christ, the King She Serves, in the title. I have been and remain very grateful to you for your prayers and to God for his steadfast love, the British monarch writes in the foreword to his book. I have indeed seen his faithfulness, she adds. And so we believe that we must be very close, because here is a 90-year-old, and we believe that the British monarch will be first to lay her crown at the feet of the Lord Jesus Christ, as Queen Victoria, her predecessor, hoped to do. And we just have to wait and see. So, a Brexit. So it was an exciting day, 23rd of June. I went to bed and it looked all very grim. Looked as if we were going to remain. But when I woke up at 7 o'clock in the morning, it was all over. 48% to remain, 52% to leave. So not a very big majority, but a sufficient majority. And after 43 years of membership of this club, the British voted that they were no longer enamoured with this club that they had joined. The yearly subscription rates was getting higher and higher. Value for money was not coming back to them. And the services that they were receiving were not what they had expected when they had signed up. The economy of the EU is in dire trouble. Exports to the EU were shrinking. And as a trading power, Britain wanted markets. But in this club of the EU, you had to abide by the rules. You weren't free to make your own negotiations. And so the British have decided to come out. Now, great song is made about Scotland. Scotland wanted to remain and is threatening to break away. But this chart shows what little influence Scotland really has. She has
8% of the United Kingdom's population. She's got 32% of the area, but only 8%. And in fact, Wales voted to leave. Northern Ireland voted to remain. So, you know, those two together, only 11%, compared with 89% wanting to leave. So, with oil down at the price it is, Scotland has no hope of an independence. She's utterly dependent on support from Britain. So I think that is a red herring. And it's interesting, when in Ezekiel chapter 38, it talks about not the merchants of Tarshish, but the merchants. Britain is a united kingdom made up of these four merchants, trading powers and their own rights, work together, the merchants of Tarshish. And so, just a few weeks ago, Britain, you might not be able to read the word there, says victory. Britain decided to sail away, break her links. Others saw it as a new door opening for Israel, for Britain, to make her own way in the world. I'll just put this on. We are nearly finished, and I'm sorry, time to come on. Brother Thomas, in Alpes Israel, 1948, I'm going to read all this, you know it by so well, but it was his conclusion. He was able to see from Scripture that Britain played an important role in the history of Israel, bringing the Jews back. And here we are, Britain again playing an important role. Now, Theresa May, who is now the UK Prime Minister, her father was a clergyman, so she has respect for the Bible. When Cameron was trying to push through and succeeded, push through gay marriage, she was one of those that voted against it. But she is a long-standing friend of Israel. Night before she became Prime Minister, and you think she'd got an awful lot on the plate, she kept a long-standing dinner date with the chief rabbi in the UK. So she is known and in the past has shown her support for Israel. The Israelis are delighted that she has become Prime Minister. They also like Boris. He now is our Foreign and Commonwealth Affairs. Yes, on the outside he appears a bit of a buffoon. He is a very clever man. He has a very strong understanding of history and the role that history plays. So yes, he might appear a bit of a Trump, but he's not. He is a very skilled person. And again, he is a strong friend of Israel. The Israelis are delighted. And Priti Patel is the Secretary of State for International Development. She again is an officer of the Conservative Friends of Israel. So the three people who are likely to influence Israel's, Britain's relationships are all friends of Israel. That's truly remarkable. Boris has already met your foreign minister, Peter Bishop. We discussed various things, and I'm quite sure that he discussed with her having a free trade agreement. Theresa May has got to face the EU and get terms for Britain's withdrawal. And she now has a very strong hand because all these Commonwealth countries said, we want to have trade agreements with you. So she'll be able to go to the EU and say, well, if you don't want to do business with us, fine, all these people do. So it's in your interest not to make too many waves. And things don't appear to change much. Our Defence Minister, Defence Secretary, is remaining in office, and he was saying here that what they're planning to do is a stronger, better defence, backed by a budget that will increase, rise year by year. More ships, more aircraft, more troops. Britain wants to be a trading merchant power again, and that's what the government is planning to do. And the Pentagon's top weapons buyer was saying, well, there's no reason to see Brexit as making any change in the relationship.
BibleTruthAndProphecy.com is a worldwide collaboration by Christadelphians to help promote the understanding of God's Word to those who are seeking the truth about the human condition and God's plan and purpose with this earth and with mankind upon it. Bible Truth and Prophecy is part of a wider set of online resources provided by Christadelphianvideo.org for establishing just how far removed the true Christian teaching of the first century apostles is from that taught by mainstream Christendom today. BibleTruthAndProphecy.com is very much a standalone website, but benefits from our vast network of sites and resources and social media. Here are just a few of the things that BibleTruthAndProphecy.com offers. We have a good number of written articles supplied to us from brothers from all over the globe. These deal with first principle issues, creation versus evolution, the inspiration of the Bible, and so much more. We have a whole section of video study series. These are studies that have been posted onto our YouTube channel, but because of the difficulty of the search feature within YouTube, we have chosen to host on Bible Truth and Prophecy. So now, every video you search for within the site, you can be guaranteed that it will be of a Christadelphian nature. We also have a preaching video section, where any ecclesia is invited to download and use or embed these videos within their own ecclesial websites. We also have an exhortation service, where we produce two or three exhortations per week, which we then circulate to brethren and sisters in isolation. We also have an ever-growing list of approved Christadelphian sites. We also have a page of live news feeds, so you can keep up to date with all the breaking news as it happens. We also have a section for the daily readings. Each day at around midnight, we publish all three of the daily readings. And then later on in the day, we publish Thought for the Days, often based on all three portions of the daily readings. Within each daily reading post, there is also a link to enable you to have the Bible chapter read to you directly. We also feature Bible in the News videos, videos which we have produced from the Bible in the News website. We also feature Brother Don Pierce's milestone snippets, which come out approximately three times a week. We also feature Andy Walton's weekly World Watch and other commentaries and analysis from other brethren on world news events. You can also subscribe to the blog and be notified of posts as they happen in real time, and also subscribe to the weekly newsletter, which is provided by Christadelphianvideo.org. Every page and post on the site has the facility to be able to leave a comment or make an observation, so please take advantage of this and let us know what you think of the site.